book of wisdom. I prayed, and prudence was given. I pleaded, and the spirit of wisdom came to me. I preferred her to the scepter and throne, and deemed riches nothing in comparison with her. Nor did I liken any priceless gem to her, because all gold, the hue of her, is as little as sand. And before her, silver has to be accounted mire. Beyond health and comelessness, I love her, and I choose to have her rather than the light, because the splendor of her ever yields to sleep. Yet, all good things come together in me and her company, and countless riches at her hands. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You know the commandments, you shall not kill, you
You shall not commit adultery. You shall not bear false witness. You shall not defraud. Honor your father and your mother. He replied and said to him, Teacher, all of these I have observed from my youth. Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said, You are lacking in one thing. Go sell what you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me. At that his face fell, and he went away sad, for he had many things. Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, How hard it is for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God. The disciples were amazed at his words. So Jesus again said to them in reply, Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle than for one who is rich to enter the kingdom of God. They were exceedingly amazed and said among themselves, Then who can be saved? Jesus looked at them and said, For human beings it is impossible, but not for God. All things are possible for God. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Lord Jesus Christ.
First part of my homily may seem like a recap from catechism, but how many of you remember the four cardinal virtues? They're the human virtues that moderate ourselves, how we think and make decisions, and how we treat other people. But the pagan philosophers before the coming of our Lord picked up on this aspect of our humanity, that there are certain virtues that we usually grow in and practice. So the four cardinal virtues are called cardinal because, as the Latin word suggests, they're the hinges. They're the foundation of the supernatural virtues that St. Paul tells us about, faith, hope, and charity. So the first virtue we typically learn around the age of reason, so about age 7, is justice. So in a nutshell, justice means that I know the difference between right and wrong, that other people have their due. In fact, the virtue of religion is an aspect of this virtue. Now, after a child learns mommy or daddy, the next word that a young child typically learns and uses a lot is no. And actually, all the moms, the third mass this weekend, okay, we usually use the word no a lot. Because a child, as they're growing, hopefully in wisdom and knowledge, they have a different idea of what they want to do, right? But mom and dad know best. So after we learn the virtue of justice, at around age 7, the next one we learn after that is temperance. So we typically will learn this between the ages of about 7 and 12. But when we temper something, like if we temper a piece of glass, like a windshield or a piece of metal, you temper something through heating it up and cooling it down a number of times. It gives it an inner rigidity. Now, we as humans have appetites. Now, some appetites we're pretty clear on, right? This kind of appetite. As a kid, I want to eat a whole bag of candy. But I learn, usually through experience, that I shouldn't do that. In my world, dessert comes first, because that way you never have to worry about having enough room in your belly for that. So I sometimes eat dessert first, and then I move on to the other stuff. But we also have intellectual appetites. We're all hardwired to know the truth. We don't deal in fake, flimsy kinds of things. We have other biological appetites for rest, right, for sleep, for physical activity, and all of these things should be tempered, right? There's a median, there's an average. I know that I should have a good diet, right? Different kinds of food contribute to my health, okay? So the next virtue that we learn after temperance And this is usually, again, after the middle school years, or sometimes during the high school years, is fortitude. When the going gets tough, what do I do? So at this point in my maturation as an individual, I usually have a really good idea of what mom and dad and other authority figures expect of me, but then I'm learning about freedom and responsibility. So how is it that I moderate and temper the desires that other people seem to be putting on me, but then I'm coming of age, right? I have to make decisions for myself. Now, the last human and cardinal virtue that hopefully we learn around the same time, so again, we're talking high school, college, is prudence. Now, the ancients called the virtue of prudence the auriga virtutinus, a Latin word meaning the chariot driver. So if you imagine four horses and a chariot guy behind them, hopefully they're all going the same direction. But if you've got one of those horses wanting to do their own thing, right, going right or left, you're going to have problems, okay? The chariot driver is going to have to discipline that other horse, right, so that they're all going the same way. So another way to understand prudence, it's the crown. It is the heading of the human virtues. Now, this all is the foundation of the supernatural life. So in Paul's letters, he will tell us that faith, hope, and charity are the most important things. They're the building blocks of our Christian life. Now, if the four cardinal virtues are the human ones, okay, we're not even getting into theology at that point. This is just human existence. Okay, we should be able to discern this and figure it out on a purely human level. So if they're the human, the supernatural and theological virtues have God as their direct object. So they're a capacity. And in our world right now, there's a temptation to reduce faith, hope, and charity into pure human sentiment. The problem is they're not. They're a capacity that God gives us. We have to be able to seek these things out. Now, our first reading from the Book of Wisdom told us that I sought, and prudence and wisdom was given to me. Compared to that, a pile of gold would be just a mound of sand. So you can't buy wisdom, you can't buy prudence. The only way to grow these things is that we have to practice, right? Practice makes perfect. So the supernatural doesn't do away with the natural, it builds on it. So when we believe in the gospel, when we believe in the good news, we have to have our humanity in line, so to say, in order. Now in today's gospel, we have the example of a young man who runs up to our Lord and he asks a very good question, right? Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And then we have a conversation about the commandments. Now again, just like the practice of human virtues, there's some Christians who basically say, okay, well, the commandments, because they're put in the negative, you know, we really don't pay attention to that kind of stuff because God is loving, and it doesn't matter what we do because God loves us, so the commandments really don't matter. Now, the problem with that is that Jesus tells us that we do have to keep the commandments. I have not come to abolish the law, I have come to bring it to fulfillment, right? Though it is possible to have an overly negative view of the commandments, we can sometimes look at our faith as a bunch of boxes that we got to check off. Okay, like, all right, I know I got to go to Sunday Mass, so I'm going to check that box off, and I know I shouldn't use God's name in vain, so I'm going to try my best not to do that, and then I know I should honor the Sabbath, so I'm going to like check my Mass box off, and I'm going to go to Mass, but then when I go home, I'm going to work. Those are working against each other, right? So the whole day, right, is a day of rest, not just for 1 hour, but for 24 hours. So I got to ask myself, how am I going to express those things that I live? Okay, so every once in a while, I talk about this for me. Sunday, I don't go into the office, I don't do email, I don't do laundry. So that's the negative stuff, the positive stuff. Hey, I make eggs and bacon, I take a solid high nap. Sometimes I'll go out and go to a park or watch a movie or something of that sort. I'll go to the gym sometimes. So again, both the positive and the negative, right? Now you notice that the Lord points out what the man lacks. So the first thing we're told, Jesus loves him. Okay? The Lord's not interested in smacking him over the head. So he loves him and he says, there's one thing you lack. If you wish to be perfect, go sell what you have and you will have treasure in heaven. So the Lord is getting to the particulars of this young man's life. So what we see going on here is an invitation to deeper and greater faith. Now we're told, however, that the man walks away sad because he has many things. And many times you and I get weirded out or freaked out because we think that if we practice our faith better, it's going to take a lot of effort, and we're afraid of the change that that is going to entail in our life. But again, practice makes perfect, no pain, no gain. So we have to train ourselves to take that attention that we pay to the pain aspect or my comfort and ask myself, okay, well, what is it that God is asking me to do or believe? Because Christianity is not for wimps, right? We were just told by St. Paul that the word of God is living and effective, sharper than any two-edged sword. So on the day of our baptism, we were given a spirit, right, that leads us to call God Abba, Father. Not a spirit of slavery or a spirit of fear, but a spirit of adoption. And the day that you and I were confirmed, we confirmed the faith that was given to us by our parents. Now, a lot of people, when they get confirmed, when I do confirmation prep with our kids, they think it's something they're doing. Now, we have to agree, God wants our freedom, but it's primarily something God is doing. God is the one doing the confirming. And the absolute tragedy of it all is confirmation, in many ways, is like graduation from faith formation. And we have to know that on the day of our confirmation, we weren't given a pat on the head. We weren't given a box of strawberry bonbons. We were given a sword. We were given the sword of the Spirit and truth of Jesus Christ, and we gotta use it, right? Not only in our life, but for the sake of other people, right? So don't be afraid to use that weapon and that tool that has been given to us in our confirmation. So if we were just told by St. Paul that the Word of God is living and effective, sharper than any two-edged sword, able to discern joints and marrow and spirit, okay, then that means that God wants us to take the interior life, the supernatural life, the spiritual life, very seriously. And our church, the Lord Jesus has given us this wealth of wisdom and knowledge. And again, I find that a lot of Christians, you know, when it comes to the Bible, they feel that, okay, I'm gonna read the Bible and then I'm gonna get everything. And it never works that way. The sacred word of God is a person, is Jesus Christ. So it's like getting to know a person. You have to listen. You have to ask questions. And first of all, you gotta show up, right? So our Catholic faith has this immense store of wisdom and knowledge in order to be human, in order to live, but ultimately to become the saints that God is calling every single one of us. We now stand and with one voice profess the faith. I believe in one God,
the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord.
prosecute and present to our Heavenly Father all of our pleas. May the gracious care of our Lord be with all who follow Christ, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
May the gracious care of the Lord be with those who govern communities and nations, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
May the gracious care of the Lord be with all those who suffer from poverty, disease, and homelessness, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
May the gracious care of the Lord be with us who worship here, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick, Marie Letieri, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have died, especially for Sheldon Allen, Fernando Calderon, and Carolyn Grabowski, and their family and friends, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for the people of Christ the Good Shepherd, for whom this Mass is offered, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We ask you, merciful God, to listen kindly to our petitions, those of the entire church. Now let us pray together Psalm 23.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. In verdant pastures he leads me to waters. Beside the still waters he leads me. He refreshes my soul. He guides me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk in the dark valley, I fear no evil. For you are at my side. For your rod and staff give me courage.
It is truly right and just our duty and our salvation Always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you so loved the world that in your mercy you sent us the Redeemer to live like us in all things but sin, so that you might love in us what you loved in your Son, by whose obedience we have been restored to those gifts of yours that by sinning we had lost in disobedience. And so, Lord, with all the angels and saints, we too give you thanks. As an exaltation, we acclaim. Similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
Pleased to do. Luther in faith and charity were pilgrims for triumph. With your servant Francis, our Pope, and Alan Vigneron, our Bishop, the order of Bishop Sol, the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. Your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children and spread throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Please join us in our communion hymn, number 813, One Bread, One Body, number 813.
One cup of blessing which we love.
Let us pray. We entreat your majesty, most humbly, O Lord, that as you feed us with the nourishment which comes from the most holy body and blood of your Son, so you may make us sharers of his divine nature, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
A few announcements this day. First is the Knights of Columbus are having their annual Tootsie Roll drive, so if you are in need of a sugar fix, please make sure to see the Knights right after Mass. The last day for registration for religious ed is tomorrow, so if you or you know of someone who needs to sign up, please either call or email the religious ed office, and you can either hop in when faith formation starts at 5:30 every Monday evening. We have a number of funerals that will be celebrated here this week. The first is for Mr. Fernando Calderon. His funeral will be celebrated tomorrow at 10 a.m. Funeral arrangements are being handled by Solosi Funeral Home. And then for Mrs. Carolyn Grabowski, her funeral mass will be celebrated this upcoming Saturday, the 16th at 12 noon. Arrangements are being handled by Alex Funeral Home. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.
Please join us in our closing hymn, number 652, We Will Serve the Lord.